our scripture this morning will come from Matthew chapter 27. In just a few short days, we'll be celebrating Easter. We'll be celebrating the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Prior to that resurrection, there were a lot of things that took place. And this morning, I want us to focus not on the events, but on the people. One of the most significant events in the story of Christmas, probably second only to the resurrection, Christmas, did I say Christmas? Easter. Second only to the resurrection is the crucifixion. A lot of things have been said about it. A lot of sermons preached. We're not going to look at the crucifixion this morning. We're actually going to look at the people that were there. I asked God that we have a discussion in Wednesday night about prayer. And I think I'm going to have to back up on some things I said, but I'm going to tell you what I decided that how we should approach prayer. We should approach prayer as being ready to receive an answer from God. Maybe not a specific answer, but to receive an answer from God. We have to be ready for that. And so prior to coming to this service this morning, I asked God to send the people that needed to hear this message. And he didn't send the ones that I thought he should send. So I'm trusting God that he knows better, and that some of you sitting in this audience this morning are those that God intended to hear this message. What you do with it is your problem. What you do with it is your responsibility. But evidently, you're the ones that are supposed to hear it. While Judy and the ladies were off at Gatlinburg, I worked like a dog. And I ventured off to the big city of Woodbury, buy the car tags for her car. And I walked in the county court clerk's office, and I've known him for ages. Miss Margie knew him before he was born. But in the process of buying car tags, he and I got into a little discussion on church. Now, the county court clerk is a church of Christ. Good one. And I'm Baptist, so, you know, oil and water. But we agreed on this. We were talking about church, and he came up and he said this. He said, people don't come to church anymore. And I really thought that odd, because we have that problem here, don't we, Brother Blaine?
Yes.
And I really didn't think that the largest church in Cannon County would have that problem. But evidently they did. Because just in our discussion, just out of the blue, he said, people don't come to church anymore. And something else that he said that I agreed with. He and I got along that day, oil and water mixed that day. He said, people don't respect God, Jesus, and the church. Now you think about that for a moment. People don't come to church, and they don't respect God, Jesus, and the church. So this morning, I want us to look at some of the people that are involved in the crucifixion of Jesus. And look at them and see just how much respect they have for Jesus. And while we're visiting them, somewhere in those categories you're going to fall. Somewhere in one of those categories you will find a home. I actually hope it's the last one. If you look at Matthew chapter 27, verses 33 through 36, it says this. And when they had come to a place called Golgotha, that is to say, place of a skull, they gave him sour wine mingled with gall to drink. But when he had tasted it, or when he tasted it, he would not drink. Then they crucified him and divided his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet. They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Sitting down, they kept watch over him there. The story of Jesus' crucifixion has the power to tell its own story. It really doesn't need someone to get up and tell you what the crucifixion was or was like. And today I'd like for you and I to venture to the hill where our Lord was crucified and died to save us all. And just take a look for just a few moments at the people that were there. You know, any public execution will draw a crowd. And I believe that today, if we executed the criminals on the courthouse square, you would have a crowd that would gather there. They don't do it anymore, so that it can be kind of a private thing. There are witnesses, but it's not a public thing. But I really believe that if there were executions on the courthouse square, as there used to be years and years ago, that there'd be a terrible crowd together to witness that crucifixion. All that day, I want you to understand too, that not only did it draw a crowd, but there were also two other individuals that were there. The two thieves. One on the right, one on the left of Jesus. And from that center cross, Jesus looked down on a lot of faces who had gathered there and who gave no respect to him. So just who are these people that we find gathered at the foot of the cross of Jesus on the day he was crucified? Well, the first group that we're going to look at is the soldiers. Now, the soldiers' purpose was to carry out the orders of the execution. There wasn't anything at all that those men could do about Jesus' fate. His fate had been sealed. They were there to carry out the orders of the execution. And some of us sitting in this room this morning might say, well, if I'd been a soldier that day, I would have let Jesus escape. Do you know the consequences for that? It would have immediately been that all of those soldiers that were there would have been crucified themselves. Jesus would still have met the death that they meant for him to have, along with all the soldiers that had been there. But these men were calloused men. They were so accustomed to cruelty and bloodshed that they really made a sport of the crucifixion. Now they did have some choices to make. A lot of the things that happened during the crucifixion really didn't have to take place. It was choices that these men who could have shown Jesus some respect and a little mercy during his death chose to treat it as a cruel thing. Chose to mete out cruelty to him. The Bible tells us that they pushed a crown of thorns down on his brow. They stuck a reed into his hand. And they tied a scarlet mantle around his shoulders as a robe and declared him, mocked him, and said, "Hail King, King of Kings." You know, they really didn't know that they were describing exactly who he was. They were mocking him, but they didn't know that they were actually telling the truth. If that wasn't enough, that they could have stopped there, but they didn't. They went on and they spat on him and they beat him. And they crucified him. They drove the nails through his hands and his feet. And when all of that was done, they gathered together at the foot of the cross that Jesus was on. And they began to gamble for his possessions. Nice bunch of people, wasn't it? Really nice bunch of folks. Able to show mercy, but chose not to. Everybody would have understood why they didn't take him off the cross, but there was still an element of mercy that could have been given that day as Jesus was crucified by that group of people, but no mercy was shown. And we see that today. We see people who are willing to crucify Jesus every single day. We see people who are willing to do it day after day after day after day and never show any mercy. Folks, those people are going to find out that when Jesus rose again, that he didn't rise for them. They had an opportunity to show mercy. They had the same opportunity that poor thief had, but they chose not to. And folks, when we don't show mercy to Jesus, there's no mercy for us. Mercy disappears. The second group of people that I want us to look at this morning, a lot of you would fit into. They were the passerbys. If you look with me in verses 39 and 40 of Matthew 27, it says, "And those who passed by blasphemed it, wagging their heads and saying, 'You who destroyed the temple and built it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross.'" These folks were the curious. They were the crowd followers. And they moved in waves of emotion and impulse. You know, we have a lot of crowd followers today. We have a lot of people that act before they think. We have a lot of people that stumble after the crowd and think they're doing the best they can. Folks, let me tell you something. The crowd will get you in trouble. The crowd will get you in trouble. There's a lot of things going on in our world today. A lot of things that I don't approve of. And some people are doing them just because other people are doing them. Some people are just being disrespectful to Christ, disrespectful to His church. And they're doing things that people just don't think about. I'll tell you some of the things that have happened here lately in this church that makes me think that we have a lot of passerbyers in here. Last Wednesday night, while we were in class, we heard the thundering herd of people, didn't we, Brother Allen? Coming right through there. And I thought they were going to come through that door. It was the kids. I don't know how they got out, or they killed a teacher, and Brad had hadn't been called yet, but I don't know how they got out, but it sounded like a thundering herd. And they stopped short of that door. If that wasn't enough, I was in the office. And I heard a thundering herd coming right through this auditorium. They were at high speed, just running as fast as they could. I caught to them. I made them come back to the front of the church and walk out. But folks, that is what people think about the church. It's not a place of respect anymore. It's a place where you can come and do whatever you want to do. We don't respect the church. We don't respect Jesus. We don't respect anybody. Another thing that bothers me is that during a class, one of the teachers here at this church did something that one of the students didn't like. And you know what they did? They sent a text message to their mother. And their mother caught me in the office. And they didn't like what was going on in class. That really wasn't the one that bothered me the most. Last Sunday night during the invitation, there were a couple of girls sitting in one of the pews. And during the invitation, they were texting. They had the phone under the down below the pew, and they were just going to it. How I caught them was, and I happened to look over there, and they raised it up. Their eyes were bad, Miss Bessie. They couldn't see it. No respect for the church. In some cases, I can understand the kids, but I can't understand the grown-ups. We've had grown-ups sit in the morning worship service here at this church and text somebody outside of the building. I wish it were legal to block cell phones. I'd go by the thing of the day and stop it. And when you came in here, your cell phone would just melt down. We have a nursery for kids. I'm thinking about presenting it to the church that we have a nursery for cell phones. You turn them in when you come through that door. And you pick them up when you leave. But all that is not the fact that you have the cell phones. It's not the fact that you don't have a lot of energy. It's the fact that people just don't respect the church, God, and Jesus. And those are the passerby, because they're usually the ones that follow the crowd. They're usually the ones that let emotion and impulse influence their lives. They're the ones that act before they think. They're the ones that stumble along. And in fact, they're guilty of doing things as one of the gang, things that they would never think of doing by themselves. It's sad. It's really sad when people, especially people who claim to be God's people, become passerby. I pray that God would talk to you and convince you through the Holy Spirit that we need to have respect for God, Jesus, His church. The third group were the religious leaders. I'm fixing to step on my toes. In Matthew 27, verses 41 through 43, it says this: "Likewise, the chief priests also walked with the scribes and elders." I mean, they got everybody. "Said, he saved others, himself he cannot save. If he is the king of Israel, let him come down from the cross and we will believe. He trusted in God, let him deliver him now, if he will have him. For he said, I am the Son of God." Folks, after condemning Jesus and demanding his death, these religious professionals followed Jesus to the place of execution. And they couldn't just stand there quietly as they watched Jesus' life flowing out. They couldn't keep their mouths shut. So they kept saying, "You are the Son of God, the King of Israel, the Messiah." They said, "If you are who you say you are, prove it." Folks, Jesus has nothing to prove to you and me. Jesus is God's Son. Jesus died on the cross at Calvary for your sins and mine. He spent 3 days in the grave, arose, and now because of His death, because of His burial, because of His resurrection, because of His shed blood, you and I can have the hope of eternal life if we'll just trust Him. But no, these religious leaders were about to lose their influence. They were about to lose their livelihood. They were about to lose everything that they had worked so hard to maintain. It was about to go out the window. So they turned against Jesus. One thing that they didn't understand was that the power that kept Jesus on the cross wasn't the nails in His hands and His feet, but it was redeeming love for everybody that was at the foot of that cross and everybody that would live for them. God's people, God's ministers, are disrespectful as well. Because we get up and sometimes we presume to know what God wants. Rather than following the Holy Spirit's leadership, we presume to know what God wants us to do. And it's not because God has said, "You go do this," but it's because we have an idea that that's what we need to do. And we talked about that last Sunday. So which group do you fall into? Don't raise your hand. Did you fall into the soldiers? How about the passers-by? Some of you will fall into that passer-by one. How about the religious leaders? If you don't fall into one of those groups, there was another group that happened to be there that day. Found in Luke. You're going to have to go over to Luke now unless you just want to look at the screen. In Luke chapter 23, verses 39 through 43, it tells of another group that were saved. Here's what it says. "Then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, 'If you are the Christ, save yourself and us.' But the other answered, rebuked him, saying, 'Do you not fear God?'" Now here was a man that was in the same situation that Jesus was. He was hanging there, had the same nails, had the same situation about to happen to him that happened to Jesus. And here was a man who respected Jesus, who looked over on that cross and saw something that no one else seemed to see that day. He saw a Savior. And when the one thief began to yell at Jesus and began to tell him things, "Save yourself and us," this man looked at him and said, "Do you not fear God, seeing you are under the same condemnation?" And we indeed justly, we deserve what we're about to get. "For we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man that's hanging between us has done nothing wrong." Then he said to Jesus, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him, "Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." There were a group of penitent people there that, and it was exemplified, represented by that thief on the cross. Now, I've heard some people say that thief wasn't actually saved. Well, you believe what you want to. Jesus is quoted in the scripture of saying that today you're going to be with me in paradise. And if Jesus said it, I believe it. Some people have said that paradise is not the same thing as heaven. Well, if Jesus is there, it's close enough. But even though you had the soldiers, even though you had the passerbys, even though you had the religious leaders that were there who respected Jesus, you had one man, at least one man at that scene that looked over and saw Jesus for who he really was. Now this man had seen and heard it all. He was there from the very beginning. He heard the soldiers cursing, laughing, gambling. He heard the passerby shouting their taunts, the religious leaders demanding Jesus to prove his claims. And folks, all of these things would have been terribly, terrible hindrances to faith. How would you like to have heard all of that and be making a decision to have faith in Jesus? That thief said, we suffer justly. And we're going to receive our due reward, but this man has done nothing. This thief admits his guilt. I've seen it. He wasn't too proud. Even though he was hanging there on the cross with Jesus, he wasn't too proud in his last few words that would be said from anywhere. He wasn't too proud to ask, Lord, remember me. And Jesus said, what? Today you'll be with me in paradise. So you have to decide. Which group of people do you belong to? Do you belong to the soldiers? Very professional and very cold. Do you belong to the passerbys? Those who for a fleeting moment might say they believe but have no grounds at all to stand on. Who mock, who follow the crowd. The religious leaders who could have accepted Jesus for who he really was, but because of their position and because of their prestige, they didn't want to believe that Jesus Christ was God's Son. So instead of talking to him, instead of becoming more familiar with him and letting him guide them, what did they do? They had the crowd turn against him and crucify him. And then they stood there and looked up and said, Jesus, if you're who you say you are, come down off of that cross. And then you have those that were sunk. That thief on that cross that day had no reason whatsoever to believe that Jesus Christ could do anything for him. Yet on that cross, even though people were yelling, even though they were screaming, even though they were cursing, guess what? He looked through it all, he pushed it all aside, and he saw Jesus for who he really was. The Son of God and the Savior of the world. And he simply said, Lord, remember me. Remember me. Remember me. Jesus looked over him and said, I'll remember you, because today you're going to be with me in paradise. Folks, if there was room at the cross for a repentant thief, then there's room at the cross for you. It's time that God's people begin to respect and love the one that saved us from our sins. Who reached in a sea full of sea, and grabbed us by the shirt collar and pulled us out. Because every single one of us was bound for hell. Jesus loved us enough to throw us a lifeline. The question is this morning, are you going to grab it and use it? Or are you going to walk away? The soldiers, the passerbys, and the religious leaders walked away. Three out of four. What do you want? What do you want? Father, thank you for your love. Thank you for your mercy. And help us this morning to decide which of those categories we fit. And Father, I really hope that we fit in that last one, the repentant thief, just as the repentant thief fit in. Heavenly Father, help us to understand that belonging to you means that we respect you every day, every minute, not when it's just convenient. Father, I pray this morning that as the Holy Spirit works in your heart, in our hearts and our lives this morning, that we'll come to see the mistakes that we've made. And that Heavenly Father, that right now we will let the Holy Spirit guide us into correcting those mistakes so that we can love and serve you better. Father, I pray for those that are lost this morning because they make mistakes too. They look and see sometimes how we act and base their decision to follow Jesus on us. Heavenly Father, I pray that they would base their decision to follow Jesus on Jesus himself. Father, send the Holy Spirit to those who convict them that they need to accept Christ as their personal Savior and give them the courage to do it today. Father, I pray that we'll be better servants for you. I pray that we'll stand up for you. I pray that we'll respect you. And that Heavenly Father, that you will have your will and your way in each of our lives. But right now, dear God, use the Holy Spirit to draw us to you as we sing this hymn of invitation. Bless those that need to make decisions this morning and give them the courage to step out. Lord, in Jesus' name, I